In the previous video, we discussed why normalization is important. Now let's take a look at two of the most common normalization techniques. So here again, we have the wine dataset as an example where we have features on various different scales. Just to get an idea of the scales, let's take a look at the mean here, the average of each feature column. And as we can see, the values range widely. And similar, we can see also that the minimum and maximum values of each feature column are wildly different. Now, one common normalization technique is 0-1 normalization, or sometimes also called min-max normalization. So here we have the feature value xj of the ith training example. And in order to normalize this feature value of the ith training example, we subtract the minimum value of the feature column j. And then we divide this value by the maximum of this feature column j minus the minimum of this feature column j. So as the name 0-1 normalization implies, the feature minimum will be at 0 and the feature maximum will be at 1 after the normalization. So using this code shown here, we normalize each data point in the data set and each feature column. And now let's double check the new minimum and new maximum values. And as we can see, all the feature columns have a minimum at 0 now, and all the feature columns have a maximum at 1 now. So 0-1 normalization is only one of the two common normalization schemes. Another, maybe even more popular normalization scheme is z-score standardization. Here again, xj represents a feature value of the ith training example. In this case, what we do is we subtract the mean of the feature column and divide by the standard deviation of this feature column. So after this z-score standardization, the mean of these features will be centered at 0 and the standard deviation of the features will be 1. Note though, in contrast to 0-1 normalization, the z-score standardization will not clip the minimum and maximum value of the feature columns. So this is how 0-1 normalization and z-score standardization work in a nutshell. Let's now see how this works in practice by applying these concepts to our training and validation sets. In fact, it's best practice to use the training set parameters for both the validation and the test set as well. That's because we always pretend that the validation and the test sets are unknown to us. We pretend it's new data, and we want to develop a technique that we can then apply to the new data. So here's how it looks in code. So we have this normalization function that will normalize the data for us, and we have to provide it with the minimum and the maximum of the training set. So once we computed the minimum and the maximum of each feature column, we can then use that to also scale the validation and the test sets. And we do the same thing for standardization. So if we have the standardization function here, we again derive the mean and the standard deviation from the training set and then apply these to scale also the validation and the test set. So this is basically all there is to it when it comes to normalization. However, you might be wondering now, when should you use 0-1 normalization and when should you use z-score standardization? In deep learning, when we use stochastic gradient descent-based learning algorithms, it's actually recommended to use standardization over 0-1 normalization. And that's because of the zero centering of standardization, which will make gradient descent behave a little bit better compared to 0-1 normalization. But again, in my experience and practice, the differences are really small and both are really good normalization methods. So in this unit, we introduced PyTorch and saw some of its core features to train neural networks. In this lecture, we focused specifically on a simple single-layer neural network, namely logistic regression. But in the next unit, we will finally make these networks bigger and get towards training deep neural networks.